This little video is just for you atheists. It's not so much the ranting and raving, screaming loonies I'm concerned about, but those who are allegedly intelligent, like Richard Dawkins and similar sort of people who love to scream and shout at God, at Christians, deny him and try and obliterate all trace of God by various devices and application to the science religion in the hope that they can retain their godship of their life. And the vast majority of atheists haven't the foggiest idea of what they're talking about. I've heard some crashingly idiotic nonsense from professed atheists as though Christians hold certain things which they don't hold at all. Now, this little video is to put you right and teach you one or two basics that might help you in your incomprehensions so that you might come to a better informed position, okay? Now, if you don't know me, my name's Justin Hughes. I am a Christian minister. I live in Southwest England, and I spend my time ministering, or you know, working as well, of course, and all sorts of things. So let me just start with the first point here, and I made one or two notes here because I have to pick up all these incomprehensions, make a little list before I can address them, of course. And it's simply because you know, there's so many of them, I'm bound to forget something if I didn't actually write this down. So excuse me if I quickly check my notes every now and again. First one. It's common to hear atheists say, God made me like I am. God made me wicked and evil and then punishes me for being so. There are people out there in professed Christian circles who ignorantly and stupidly assert that God made them. That is not true. All right? The Lord God of Israel has only ever made three people through all history. Everybody else has a hand-me-down derivative life. You are the product of a union, initial union between the first man and the first woman, and the various children and descendants thereafter. You have a hand-me-down life. The Lord God of Israel, your owner and your enemy with whom you have no contact or access to, he did not make you. He was not involved in your being here. Your father made you in your mother. And whilst the Lord God can allow or disallow conception, by and large, he lets it all roll. Okay. God didn't make you anything. You were conceived and born, nothing to do with him. You are utterly cut off from him. You know it, you can feel it, and you have no access to him. And by all the parameters you have access to, he doesn't exist. But you must allow that there might be people who do know him. All right. If he didn't make you and you're nothing to do with him, you'll understand that his things don't apply to you. So, next little point was, firstly, God did not make you, you're nothing to do with him, and the only reason why people are annihilated come judgment day is because they're not God's people. All right? What they did as not God's people is absolutely academic. So the next thing you need to know about this is the law of the Lord God of Israel, that you'll know about. There is a law of God, and you'll know the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ and the apostles, and you'll know that the Bible, maybe you've gone to one of these lovely find faults with the Bible atheist sites where there's umpteen apparent contradictions to outsiders, inevitably. And they all have a lot of fun trying to pull apart the Bible. The Bible is not God. Christians start with God and they have a Bible. There are loads of Christians out there, nominal Christians, who all they have is church and a Bible. They've been brought into Christianity, but they miss Jesus himself altogether. So God's people know him and they come to the Bible from a place of knowing him. You're an outsider, an enemy of God. You come to God from a place of being utterly cut off from him, and inevitably the perspective is different. So let me just assure you, firstly, that the law of Almighty God, what the Bible says or doesn't say, what the Old Covenant and the New Covenant and how things work do not apply to you. They do not pertain to anything you have. They do not pertain to have anything you have access to or could have access to. All right? Your problem before God is nothing to do with breach of some article of the law of God. Your problem is simply you're not one of his people. And you know and you can feel that you're cut off from God and you're nothing to do with him, that you're an outsider. You can feel it, can't you? So when someone says to you, the law of God says so-and-so, so-and-so, and you're doing this, that, and the other wrong, you can tell them, I am not one of God's people, and the law of God does not apply to me. Whatever the Lord Jesus Christ taught, said, or whatever, or the apostles said, doesn't apply to me. All right? Okay, so let's get that straight to start with. Your only problem, atheist, or agnostic, or whatever else you are, or religious or irreligious, doesn't make any difference at all. Your only problem is you're not with the Lord Jesus Christ. You have no access to the Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't speak to you because you're not one of his people. You are utter, total, and absolute outsiders. It is nothing to do with what the Bible says or doesn't say. Right, let's get that straight. And the Lord God of Israel does not expect or require anything from you. So then, if the Lord God of Israel does not expect or require anything of you, you shouldn't be feeling under condemnation. You shouldn't be feeling bad about how you live your life. The Lord God doesn't expect anything of you. He only expects things of his people. And the law of God does apply to God's people, but how it's applied in the New Covenant era is very different to how it's applied in the Old Covenant era. It's common to hear the ignorant, the atheistic science religion types saying, oh, well, you know, look, God casts gaze into the lake of fire, and adulterers and all sorts of other celebrities into the lake of fire. Well, yes, it's true. But let me just correct another little misunderstanding here. The only reason why people go to the lake of fire come judgment day is simply they're not his people. What you did in the camp of not his people is nothing to do with it. Okay? You'll have dear sweet old ladies who have apparently not done anything wrong all their life going to the lake of fire. You'll have liars going to the lake of fire. You have sodomites. You'll have adulterers. You'll have whores and fornicators. There'll be Hindus, Catholics, Buddhists, Sikhs, Mormons, and all sorts of people going to the lake of fire. Why? Simply because they're not God's people. It's nothing to do with any crime they've committed. Okay. Right. The Bible, which lots of atheists love to try and tear to pieces, the Bible is not for you. You should look upon the Bible as the handbook for a specific model of car. You don't own the car, and reading this particular handbook for this car isn't going to make you a car owner driver. No amount of getting degrees in intellectual understanding of the handbook for the car will make you that car's owner driver. Until you have God for yourself in your experience, like the actual Christians do, don't bother reading the Bible. Don't bother going to church, etc. It's about as ridiculous as going down to the local garage and pretending to be a car owner driver when actually you've never even got the car, never even seen it, touched it, or whatever in all your life. But there you are, stood in the workshops. You know, no cars around, it's just a group of people pretending to be car owner drivers. That's as ridiculous as it is. Until you can hear Jesus Christ himself speak to you, until you have contact with him and you know him like his people do, don't bother with the manual. The Bible was not written to, for, or about you. It doesn't pertain to anything you've got or have access to or could have access to. One of the things it's very, very common to hear atheists speak about is they want proof of God. You get some poor benighted little soul like Richard Dawkins and such people rambling on about proof and evidence. Well, the scripture itself says that they aren't going to be given proof, but actually the proof is all around you. This behind me here is a result of the creation of God. Now, initially, of course, the creation looked very different to this. The whole world was temperate at one time before Noah's flood time. That's about 4,500 years ago. And indeed, there is a fossilized deciduous forest in the Arctic Circle. We're saying very careful not to mention, of course, because that does rather give them a problem, doesn't it? But nevertheless, God is not going to give you proof. The creation around you is all the proof you're going to get. The evidence and witnesses to the existence of God are his actual people who make you feel uncomfortable, whom, against whom you rail and scream all the time. And proof would not avail anything. There's no such thing as becoming a Christian by proof. Doesn't happen. Salvation from sin unto God, that is, getting moved from the camp of Satan, those who are not his people and nothing to do with him, into his family and camp, that is a result of the sovereign action of God in the lives of those he wants to work in. If he doesn't choose to work in you, it ain't going to happen, all right? Even if you had conclusive and absolute proof and you really believed what the Bible said, you cannot become a Christian like that. No amount of proof will make any difference. There was a man that Jesus Christ raised from the dead called Lazarus. Before hundreds of witnesses, they all knew they'd put him in the grave 3 days earlier, 4 days earlier, they put him in the grave. He died. He was all bound up in the way to bury, manner to bury was in that day and age. And of course they had to deal with the bodies quickly in those kinds of temperatures because they rot rather fast. So he'd been in the grave for 4 days by the time Jesus got there and called him out of the grave. Conclusive proof, yes. What was the reaction of the elders of the Jews at the time? All they wanted to do was get rid of the Lord Jesus Christ. They were plotting on killing him because he was doing mighty miracles and proof all over the place, and they really didn't want proof. They were only concerned that the Romans would come and take away their place and their nation. They were only concerned about their status, all right? And indeed, they were plotting to kill Lazarus. All that would happen if you were given absolute conclusive proof would be that it would bring out Satan the killer in you, and all you'd want to do would be to do away, to get rid of the proof. There is no salvation by proof anyway. You aren't going to get any proof, and the chances of you actually being saved in proof is zero. God works in you or he doesn't, and there's nothing you can do about it. So, evolution couldn't possibly have happened by the second law of thermodynamics, couldn't have happened by known rules of genetics. Evolution could not possibly have happened, but evolution as part of the atheistic science religion is very useful for you, because what they're trying to do is blot out a consciousness of God, these people who believe in this myth, so that they can retain the godship of your life. And here's the rub. The rub in this is you will not have Yahweh, the Lord God of Israel, your owner and your enemy, rule over you. You wish to be God in your own life, your way. Don't you? You want to set your moral standards your way, how you like them, and not answer to anybody else. You are your own God, small g, and you live in unbelief. Those two legs are the two legs upon which sin stands. Freedom from God and unbelief. That's the satanic nature that you were conceived and born with. You won't submit to him who is God. And evolution tends to feed that, because evolution makes you the master. But there's a small problem with this. The science religion myths like evolution might divest you of any consciousness of Yahweh, the Lord God of Israel, your owner and your enemy, but you've got a problem, because it also means that the moment you die, you're utterly, totally annihilated. Okay? The science religion does not dispute you will be annihilated. It only disputes when you're annihilated, how you're annihilated, and how many are annihilated. As Richard Dawkins very ably himself put it, when we die, that's it. We're only animals. You are, in other words, utterly, totally, and absolutely annihilated without hope. Nobody on the planet has any hope for their life. Nothing whatsoever. What's the point of building anything? You might as well spend your whole life in a drunken haze and live your a thoroughly debauched life. You have no reason to build anything. None at all. And no reason to behave yourself. There's no reason why you can't go around killing people. Because you don't happen to like them. I don't like you. Bang. Why? Because that's right by your standards. You are your own God. And there's absolutely no hope, and there's no justice, none whatsoever. There's no trial in a court of law. You know, if this were a normal situation in the world, and people, people like Amnesty International got hold of this, you know, like somebody wasn't getting a fair trial, there would be a hue and cry. We want a fair trial before proper unbiased judges and proper jury and all this kind of stuff. You can't have that, and yet, when science religion teaches everybody's absolutely annihilated without hope, without justice, and without appeal, they're very quiet and they don't take on the science religion and rebuke them sharply and insist there is justice, do they? Strange that, isn't it? And the reason why, of course, is Amnesty International is hotly anti-God, just like you are. So, firstly, the science religion then doesn't dispute annihilation. All that happens is I'm telling you that annihilation isn't going to happen the way you think it's going to happen. You will have trial in a court before the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the judge of all the earth and judges to perfection of righteousness and decency. And in that court on that day, there is a certain great amount of appeal. You can cry out to him and say, why am I not included? No problem. There is hope because God is extending salvation to some people on the earth, and some people have hope of eternal life. But in the atheist people, they'd simply are quite happy to accept utter annihilation, because to do anything else divests them of their godship. And here is the reason why most people cling to atheism and all this kind of stuff. So it's absolutely crazy. And once when you get a cell, a living cell, which is shown to be shown to have evidence of design, they would rather believe the planet was seeded by aliens, like Richard Dawkins believes, who are far more evolved than we are, than believe the truth that God made it and God designed it. Because, of course, Mr. Dawkins wishes to be God, looked up to and respected by the people around him. Mr. Dawkins doesn't wish to be kicked off his perch and made a mere scientist, merely finding out how God made things and what can be done with that which he's made. How utterly tragic. Mr. Dawkins has fallen into the merely religious person's trap. And you atheists are doing exactly the same as a lot of merely religious people do, that when they get caught out in some unfortunate detail of their religion, which is found to be untenable or downright wicked or something, they immediately start looking for casting around for all sorts of excuses, ways of getting around and stopping the truth impacting against their religion and knocking their religion down. There you are in the atheist religion, the science religion, gleefully hanging on to your ideas, desperate that you maintain them. So remember this, that as a science religion believer, an atheistic science religion believer, actually you're not divesting yourself of anything, because you already believe you're going to be utterly annihilated anyway. The difference I'm saying to you is, you will have justice, there is appeal, and there is hope that at some time in your life God will change you. But as things happen, you have nothing to do with him, you have no access to him, and you've never heard him speak to you, and by all the parameters you have access to and know, there is no God. But you must understand there are God's people around who know him, All right? So, Mr. Dawkins and his aliens, eh? Oh, dear, dear. I hear people like Mr. Dawkins accusing Christians of child abuse, of teaching children Christianity. He calls it child abuse. Of teaching them that there is a God who owns them, who sustains all things. There is a reason for this world. And the vast majority of humanity have nothing to do with him. However, there is hope that some people will find him and come to him who owns all things. He calls that child abuse, that there's going to be punishment later on for those who are not his. He calls that child abuse. But hang on a minute. Mr. Dawkins teaches, as does all the science, religion and the atheists, to all kids that they have no intrinsic value. They are worthless. They are only the result of a tail end of a string of fantastic pure chances anyway. They have no intrinsic value and no reason to be here. They are therefore worthless. And they are only as good as their performance. How pretty they are, handsome they are, intelligent they are, how much money they got, what job they do, how many friends they've got, who they know, what they know, all these kinds of things that human beings use to evaluate one another and test their value. But the plain fact of the matter is that people do not, in the science and atheistic religion, have intrinsic value. If this isn't created all around us, then you have no intrinsic value. You're only a chance event. You are worthless, intrinsically. Also, they teach these children they are hopeless. Utter, total, and absolute annihilation. The moment you die is all that's on the cards for you. And when they have a member of their family dies, inevitably will happen as they grow up, then they have to face the fact that that dear one that they loved so dearly, and there's no love in the science religion at all. No love, it's all nasty, hard stuff. Eugenics and euthanasia is all included, of course. When this one dies, they have to face the fact that their near and dear one was utterly annihilated. And this devastates them, because they know they're next. It's only a matter of time. You might live until you're an old, old person. And I hope you do. And you live a long and a happy life. But I'm afraid you could die quite young. The other day, Steve Jobs of Apple died. According to the science religion, utterly, instantly, and absolutely annihilated, without hope, without justice, and without appeal. Christopher Hitchens has esophageal cancer. Poor man. On his way to a lost eternity. That poor man is on his way to utter, total annihilation. His hatred for God is so strong, he's more than happy to be utterly, instantly annihilated. If only he can cheat God of judging him on the judgment day, that's what he wants. It's the hatred for God and the satanic nature that's in human beings that drives Mr. Hitchens. How utterly sad, but unfortunately, Steve Jobs and Christopher Hitchens, Steve Jobs probably already is already in Hades. As I recall this, as far as I know, Christopher Hitchens is still alive. You know, if you're watching this video sometime later on, he may have died by the time you watch this. But what would happen to him? Straight to Hades. Translated death in English, which is best understood a wretched remand prison for those that died without Christ who were never his. The other sister remand prison, hell, temporary place again until judgment day for those who died with Christ who were without Christ who were his but who apostatized, and heaven, another temporary place for those that died with Christ to await judgment day. Okay. However, by the time you're watching this, maybe both those men, Steve Jobs and Christopher Hitchens, are both in Hades. Astonished that they're still awake, aware and stuff, and what is this wretched, horrible place that I'm in now? And somebody will remind them, this is just a temporary place until we stand judgment before Christ. At which point, of course, they realise, oh dear, I wish we'd listened to God's people, because now we've got no way out. Never mind. But to tell children that they are worthless, they are hopeless, and only as good as their performance is child abuse. We have in the UK record numbers of teenage suicides going on. Huge numbers. Teenage and early 20s. Because these youngsters have grown up and they've been told constantly the mantra by lying scientists, lying school teachers, lying media people, all sorts of liars around them. You're worthless. You're hopeless. You're only as good as your performance. And if for some reason or other they feel they can't perform, that life is not going well enough for their liking, they want to end the pain, only to discover a short time later it was all a lie, and there they are in Hades earlier than they probably would have gone there anyway. If only someone had told them that there is love in the world, and in a science religion it is absolutely hopelessness and lovelessness. And that mantra is being preached at the kids all the time. You're worthless, you're hopeless, and only as good as your performance. And is it any wonder why depression is so great? Do you know what gives people their worth? Somebody loves them. And if you're an outsider, an enemy of God, God does not love you, okay? He does love his people, Israel. Israel today, generally called Christians, the actual Christians in the UK today, that's 10 to 20,000 people, something like that. He does love them, and his love is upon them. Amongst them, there's two types, the narrow wayers and the broad roaders, and the broad roaders are on a divergent path from him, but nevertheless, the vast majority of the British people are not Christians any more than you are watching this. So these poor kids and umpteen others go and kill themselves in a hope of ending it all. Don't you even think about it. You live your life on this earth as long and as happily as you can, because what's coming afterwards for the vast majority is not a lot of fun. So the reason why people push for atheism, the reason why they are constantly doing this, is quite simply because they won't have the godship of their life interfered with. It's hatred for God and a desire to retain the godship of your own life that drives the vast majority of these people. They are going to be their own God. They will set their standards their way. If they believe that something is morally okay, it's okay, without any reference to him who says what the morality is going to be on the earth. And there is the rub, friend. There it is. The reason why you're into atheism is because you love to be your own God, free from him who owns you. And those who die in freedom from him who owns them get freedom from him who owns them forever. You will probably have your annihilation. The vast majority of people do get annihilated. But the reason you won't get annihilated just the moment you die, without hope, without mercy, without justice, without appeal, you won't. You will have justice in a proper court before a judge who's exactly, precisely correct, knows everything, and before whom nothing can be concealed. So hang on in there. I look forward to seeing you on that day and hearing your words. I wish we'd listened to you.